Yes, so my name is Iwan Baan. I've been photographing basically since I was a kid and I got my first camera. I went to art school, studied there photography, and for a couple of years after art school, did much more documentary photography. And it was a little bit by accident that I fell into the whole architecture field through my fellow Dutchman, Rem Koolhaas. And he got me completely hooked up in the architecture field, and I got completely fascinated with that field. And for me, it was really a way to combine my interest in, places and people, how people live in all kinds of different places around the world, and what influence architects make in that field. That was for me kind of my entrance into the architecture field. And I still consider myself not really an architectural photographer. It's like, of course, my commissioned work is these days mainly from architects or their clients, or has to do a lot around all the issues around the built environment. But for me, the field is much broader, that trying to document how people live in very different circumstances all around the world. Yeah, they're always come via different ways. Of course, there's a lot of long-term collaborations I have with many architects, where I document all their projects for others. There's like commissions coming in and out, but what I enjoy a lot is also collaborations, for instance, with universities or institutions, more focusing on a specific subject, on a specific city, on a specific living condition, and really explore it in that way. And out of that come a lot of books or exhibitions or different kind of longer term projects than just a commission for a new building, also offers me, of course, a chance to travel a lot. But those longer term collaborations are really interesting always. And then besides that, you come all the time in very different places where you sometimes encounter really unusual circumstances, subjects, places, people, and so on, out of which other projects are born, which are kind of self-initiated. Yes, I think there's different projects which come to mind, but probably the project which reached the widest audience also outside the architecture field is that image I took of the big storm Sandy when it hit New York 7 years ago. I happened to be in the city because of another commission, which was postponed, of course, because of the big storm, and there was no electricity and so on. So, and as a big part of my sort of visual language of projects I photograph are these aerial pictures over places, over cities, over buildings. And so I thought like the only way to capture this moment with a city without electricity, and especially at night in the complete darkness, is this aerial shot over the city. So I happened to find a pilot whom I knew outside the city who could fly me back into the city, and I took that image of New York over the in the complete darkness, where you really saw the divide of the city in the dark and the part of the city which still had electricity, and it became the cover of New York magazine and sort of became a kind of iconic image of that unique moment and the vulnerability of a big city in this kind of time. So that kind of went all over the world. But besides that, probably the project I did together with Urban Think Tank on the Torre David in Caracas, for which we got the Golden Lion in Venice. These kind of projects, they, I think, touch a wide audience. Like They're very unusual living conditions for a lot of people, but I find them very interesting because, like, yeah, people find such different ways to live all around the world. And for these people, it was a total normal way of, yeah, finding a home and creating a home out of almost nothing. And these kind of challenges, how people create kind of places for themselves, I find totally fascinating and important to share also with a wide audience and show to a very different audience who's not familiar with these kind of places. Now, a project where I worked on a lot over the last year and a half, 2 years, together with Tatiana Bilbao, a Mexican architect. She initiated this project, a collaboration with 11 universities around the US and Mexico, who each university and each professor with his students was doing research on one specific aspect, specific location, either in the US where you saw the Mexican influence in America or the American influence in Mexico and all the issues around the border. And that project started just after Trump got elected, and we thought like it would be really important to show like, yeah, what are these differences and commonalities between these two countries, and yeah, what the impact of the border has between these two parts of the Americas. Totally fascinating subject, I thought, and all the projects, they were with architecture universities and students who thought about, yeah, how these places could be improved or could work in a way. But my photography was really looking, yeah, well, how can you visualize this, the Mexican influence in America in these places and vice versa, and all these issues around the border. Really fascinating subject and totally different places all around the Americas, which we visited. And it's we're still working on the book, and there's an exhibition around it. And like it's gaining some traction and some recognition, but I feel also like with the issues we're facing right now with COVID and like all the mass migration, which took a complete turn the other way around. Like it feels, we're living at the moment in a very different world where these issues are very differently or, yeah, maybe not recognized so much. So I'm not sure in what kind of way this will unfold, this project. Yeah, it's strange in the last, 15, 18 years that I've been working with architects, I felt there is quite a shift in one way. Design and architecture got a lot of recognition, but I feel also like the big newspapers like cut back a lot on architecture, like the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. And it's difficult sometimes to reach a very wide audience outside the architecture bubble and architecture field with architecture magazines. And of course, like at the same moment, it's hard to really judge, but because at the same moment we live in a time, I think, that there are more magazines and more architecture magazines than ever. And there's also so many, of course, online ways to promote architecture. And so there's, I think, both ways, but sometimes it feels very much that we're in a very small architecture bubble living, especially when the issues at the moment are becoming so big and so touching every point of life. So.